But Brit. Okay. Is that okay? Is that why you're here? If you're not, now is the time to leave. Okay. So the first thing I want you to do, so everybody seems to make you do some work, so I have to make you do some work as well. So can you pair up with somebody? I'd like you with your friend to answer the following two questions. What do you expect from the next 2 days? Oops. What would you like to happen? What would you like to have happen over the next 2 days? So today, tomorrow. How are you going to measure your success? Simple questions, right? Find somebody to talk to. What are you looking for? How will you know it's been successful? A minute. How long do I have till 12 o'clock, right?
Sorry?
The slot is till 12.
Yeah.
I can't see, it's too small.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm aiming for 12. Have you ever tried to do this with people who are not from our community? So you do this and they just look at you and keep on talking, yeah? So I just like to hear a couple of things from some people that had a good conversation. So what are you looking for from the next 2 days? Who's gonna shout? Come on. Yes? You're looking for inspiration.
For self-development and knowledge.
Inspiration, self-development and knowledge. Anything else? Anything else somebody would like to have happen? Yes?
I would say what Ivo promised to me.
Do we want to know? One idea on how to inspire people. Okay, one more. One more from this side of the room.
Networking.
Networking. You would like networking.
At least 5 new connections.
You would like 5 new connections. Okay, so I'm going to start with you and go backwards. So how would you, what would be your indicators of success?
I have at least 5 connections.
At least 5 connections. So that's a measure of success. Okay. I'm going to go to the same people just to keep it simple. What would be your measures of success, your indicators of success? Do we have that one idea, right? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So was it a promising idea? Did it sound good? And then was it really good? When I tried it, it turned into crap. So it wasn't such a good idea after all. Okay, excellent. And what about you? What's your indicator of success?
I will go back. Mm-hmm. Try some new things in the, with my teams and see either result if they like it or not, and they would give me feedback.
Okay, so try those new ideas with the team and get some feedback.
Yeah.
It's interesting. I was hoping nobody would say, I want to attend 17 sessions, and altogether I want to spend 15 hours at least in the sessions. Right? Nobody measures success by number of things that they have done a number of hours they have spent. And yet often, back in our organizations, that's how we are measured, how busy we are, right? So that's my kind of first way to point out the difference between outputs and outcomes. Outcomes are what would you like to achieve? You want one idea that is implementable so that you can implement it and make a difference. Let's talk a bit about the language of outputs. And let me make sure, I said at the beginning, nothing is wrong or right by itself. Okay, some things are, but most things are contextual. So there's nothing wrong about this, it's how we're using it and what it makes us do. So business case, project, project approval request, project scope, project initiation document. Then we have requirements, and then we do tasks to implement those requirements, and then we deliver something, deliverables. And then we have post-implementation review. Do you know how some people call post-implementation review? Post-mortem. Yeah, patient has died. Let's figure out what we did wrong so we can learn for the next patient. And then we have user acceptance and whatever. There's nothing wrong with any of these, but we're using them to constrain us very often. So there's some conversations that you have and you remember them for years because they were either really made you feel good or made you feel bad and question yourself. So I remember this conversation I had with a seasoned project manager at one of my clients about 3 years ago. He says, Dragan, it's all the same bullshit, right? This agile thing, it's all the same as before. And it made me feel really, it really hurt me because I didn't have the immediate response. I couldn't say, no, it's not, and then explain it. I could say, no, it's not. Because now we have Scrum. That is not the difference. And I'm a very slow learner. It takes me years to learn something and to understand. So part of the reason I think why he was saying it's all the same bullshit, because we are still using the same language to describe fundamentally different concepts. And hopefully by the end of this session, you will share some of that view if you don't already. So, you're all familiar with the iron triangle of project management, traditional iron triangle. So we have scope, budget, and schedule, and a good project manager needs to keep all of these three and deliver within them. So we deliver all of the scope within the time and budget, right? And if we do that, we are good project manager or good whatever we are, manager or practitioner. And then Agile came around and Agile turned it upside down. So Agile says, we have fixed schedule and we have a cross-functional, cross-component team working within that time. So that's the fixed budget. And we deliver as much of the scope as we can. Yeah, so something needs to flex. One of these three always needs to flex. So it's the scope that Agile says it flexes. But we're still talking about scope. Scope. It's a bunch of requirements, right? It's output. So Agile Manifesto, we've done the exercise earlier. Working software. And what happens when you deliver working software? What happens next? And sometimes it almost feels like we stop there because that's how far we can go. Oh, we've delivered, we're successful. And then it sits on the shelf and never gets released, or it gets released and nobody's using it. Okay? Has anybody had situations like this? So Scrum, we talk about product backlog. It's a backlog of work, right? There are some people that are arguing against backlogs now. There's a movement, hashtag no backlog. There's hashtag no everything. No backlog, no projects, no estimation. There's all sorts of no's. But what should we do? Right, potentially shippable product increment. Okay, fair enough. It's working, but is anybody going to be using it? Velocity. Velocity is really, really dangerous. You start measuring velocity across teams. You guys are not as good as these guys. They deliver twice as much, right? And then on the Kanban side, again, I mean, these are great things, really useful things, but they're all focusing on the work, on the output. And then we have a book that Jeff Sutherland, who's one of the co-creators of Scrum, has written. And Jeff is a great guy, and him and Ken Schwaber have given so much to the community. But I have a real problem with the title of this book, and that's because I'm lazy. I don't want to do twice the work, right? And in the organization where I am at the moment, people who I have been working with had a meeting with the chief operating officer. And they were trying to come up with a snappy statement that would articulate the purpose of the whole transition to Agile. And he came up with this, right? More stuff, more quickly. We just need to do more stuff. So thankfully, these guys, I must have done something well, because they challenged him on that, and they changed it to write stuff more quickly. It's a bit better. I actually quite like it, write stuff. Now you get the question of, well, how do we know it's right and all of that, and we talk about that. But I like that much more. And this is, I said earlier to the guys who were working with me on the principles, this is my favorite principle. So we're not talking about doing twice the work. We should be talking about maximizing the amount of work not done. Right? So minimizing the amount of work done, but maximizing the value. Okay? I wish I can see the screen of the laptop, because I've no idea what's coming next. Now I can't see this screen either. Okay. Has any of you heard of the guy called John Cutler? I really recommend reading some of his stuff on Medium or Google him up. He has some really good stuff. He writes a lot about things that matter. And this is something from one of his blogs. Do you sometimes feel like you are just sitting in the factory cranking out features and sending them down the line? So he calls this feature factory. I spoke to a couple of people earlier today, and they were talking about using feature factory in a positive way. And when you think about lean and how lean is making the factory more efficient and more productive, that's all good stuff. But you don't want to work in the feature factory, because features are what? Output. You just do stuff, more quickly. That's the feature factory. These are the, he has a list of 12, John Cutler has a list of 12 signs that you're working in a feature factory. I adopted it, 12's too many for me. So I can deal with up to 7, after that I lose it. And I changed it slightly. I don't know if I should go through all of them in the interest of brevity. But we don't know why we're doing stuff. That's the first problem. We disconnected from the customer, from the business objectives. We obsess about prioritization of our backlog, but there's no validation that when we deliver something, we've actually done something useful. The work is treated... The only thing that really matters is the new features, new functionality. What about improvement? What about refactoring? What about improving the ways we're working as a team, as an organization? That's all irrelevant. Let's just churn some new stuff, right? The delivery roadmap only shows features. It doesn't show the outcomes. Our scope gets fixed too far into the future. We use output metrics. We deliver this many features, and we get no feedback. I said I wouldn't go through them, and I did. I lied. Okay, and then two statements that I really like. The first one is from Dave McClure, who's the guru of product management. Customers don't care about your solutions. They really don't. The only thing they care about is their problems. So don't sell your solutions, solve their problems, or help them solve their problems. And the much simpler one from my friend Mike Burrows, who says, make sure you always know what you are doing, who you are doing for, and why. Now, I'm expecting special bonus points from the organizers of the conference, because I have used the right color. Right? I highlighted all the words in the conference colors. At the very least, I should get a t-shirt. Okay, so how is language of outcomes different? It doesn't help that those two words are so similar, output, outcome. like efficient, effective. People always get them confused. So somebody mentioned Goiko earlier, my compatriot, and a very, very clever guy. So I saw him talk about this once. This is, I don't know how he calls it, but it's kind of the quality pyramid. And at the bottom, we make sure that it's working, it's functional. Whatever we produce, and it doesn't have to be software, whatever we produce, it's working, right? That's great. But it's not good if it's not operational. So it's going to stay working. It's not going to go offline. It's not going to come off. It's going to work in different circumstances. And then it's usable. It's not just functional and operational. It's usable. People can use it. And that's, we're quite good at these three layers. We test them. We make sure our solutions are them in most circumstances. What do you think goes above? Dark screen. It's used. So it's useful. Here it is. Whatever. Is it used? What's on the top? It begins with you as well. It's useful. People are using it and they're finding it useful to solve their problems. Okay? So from outputs to outcomes is a simple way of looking at it. Okay, so here's some words, and because it's a new language, this is my way to get out of it. There's fewer words, we have fewer words. So we start with a purpose. And I was inspired, that's a pretty big word, I started reading this book called Lean Change Management, and one of the last slides provides all the list of things that I refer to, so I'm assuming you're going to get the slides in some sort of form, so you can have a look. Jason Little talks about the lean change cycle, I think he calls it, and I took that as the basis, and I kind of overcomplicated it a bit, but I'm going to talk you through it quickly. So, you start with a purpose. Why are you here? Who are you serving? What problem are you solving? What need are you meeting? What's your purpose? And then, what would you like to have happen then? So that's your outcome, but that's your desired outcome. What would you like to have happen? That's my favorite clean question. I don't know if anybody came across clean language. Next question, how could we make it happen? What are the options? So they're not requirements, they're options. What we have in the backlog really should be options. These are the things that we could do. And we almost certainly won't do all of them, but we need to pick and choose carefully, right? What are the options? What could we do to make it happen? What are we going to try? People get itchy when they hear experiments. Oh, so you mean it can fail? What are we going to try? What are we going to get? What is the actual outcome? If we're lucky, we could get what we expected, what we wanted. Likely, we're going to get something slightly or fundamentally different. And then we look at the difference between what we wanted and what we got, and we learn something. We get an insight. And then we go around this cycle. So this is your value creation cycle. So we choose an option, we decide what to do, what to experiment on, we deliver something, we find out how different it is from what we originally wanted, we get a learning, we get some insight, we either pick another option or create new option, and then we cycle around that. So that's the first loop. The second loop is the learning and transformation loop or cycle. So at the same time, we should be learning and improving. That's the 12th principle of the manifesto. At regular intervals, the teams retrospect. It doesn't say retrospect. But we look back at ourselves and we find out what we could improve. So that's the green bit underneath. We don't just churn out features, we also look at ourselves and improve the way we work as individuals, as the teams, and as the organizations. Okay? And then from time to time, guess what? We had a purpose and we said we wanted this to happen, these desired outcomes. But once we've been through this loop several times, We need to go back and say, have we learned something new? Do we still want the same thing? Have we done enough? Can we now move to something else? Or do we want to continue with this one? Or do we want to change the desired outcome? So now we want something different. Or maybe our whole purpose has changed. We discover that that customer group doesn't exist, or we now serve their need, we want to move on. We need to go back to the original idea. So that's how these change cycles work. Another friend of mine has come up with a slightly different model. He calls it wholehearted delivery. And you do the purpose to validated outcomes in the middle, that's your delivery, value delivery and improvement delivery, and then you have two feedback cycles that look like a heart. And he takes a quote from somebody who I haven't come across before, who talks about wholehearted way we should build the buildings in our cities. But it applies to building solutions, software, or otherwise. Okay? I didn't say at the beginning, I should have said, if you had questions or you get confused at any point, can you stop me and ask? Are there any questions at this point? Because I think we're now moving to the final third bit. Any questions? How much sense does this make? Is it like, I should have gone to the other session? No? A bit.
Let's see it then.
Let's see.
Let's see at the end.
Let's see at the end. Let's wait for another 10, 15 minutes. Okay. So, interesting maybe, but a bit theoretical. So how does this really work? What can you do to make this happen? So I picked few tools that I have been using, and I'll just go through them and explain if that's okay. So the first one is from Goiko again. So Goiko Agis has written a little book called Impact Mapping. Anybody familiar with impact mapping? Few people? See, this side is much better. There's more people here. Your velocity is better. Anybody used it? Okay, excellent. So can you explain? So what we normally do is, these are all the things in the backlog. Let's prioritize them, right? And the people who are hashtag no estimates and hashtag no prioritizing and stuff are saying, no, we should not do that at all. Just do stuff and see what happens. And maybe that's a good thing, it's a brave thing to do, but maybe it won't get you where you want. That's your outputs. I call them capabilities. So what are the capabilities that you can produce and provide to your customers? And the combination of people, process, technology, data, anything like that. What can we give to our customers so they can use to change their behavior, to produce impact, to create impact? Which is why he calls it impact mapping. So he maps the deliverables to the behavior changes. So what can they do now that they couldn't do before? What can they do more of than they could do before? What could they do differently and better? What could they stop doing because they now don't need to do it because there's a better way to get the outcome? So you would normally start with a goal. What do we want to achieve? And making that goal, a smart goal, is really difficult when you're talking to the business people and you say, well, how are you going to measure it? We want to be best in class, blah, blah. Okay, how are you going to measure it? How are you going to measure the success for you of this conference? You were much better at coming up with number of people and number of new ideas. So what do you want to achieve? How are you going to measure it? Who can help you or stop you from achieving that goal? How would those individual people, roles, groups, functions in the organization need to change their behavior so that they help you achieve your goal? And what could you provide them with so that they can change their behavior so that they help you achieve the goal? So instead of prioritizing that stuff there, what you could and should be doing is mapping it onto this and saying, which of these paths, there's two certain ways to fail. One is not to do any of this. Second is to try to do all of it. You don't do this to do all of it. You do this to find the most promising paths through the map. Do you know what? That is the most important actor. And that's probably the most important, most promising behavior change. If they were to be able to do that, we will achieve our goal. What can we do to help them? So you just do one or two of these things and test and measure. Has the behavior changed? If yes, great. If no, do we want to continue or do something else? If the behavior changed, has it moved the dial? Have you changed? Have you moved closer towards the goal? So you're mapping all of the stuff, all of the options that you could be doing to the outcome that you want to achieve. So these are outcomes, and the other things are outputs. Again, they're not good or bad, but you should really start from left to right. You should start from the outcome. Still make sense? Okay, the second one, I'm assuming a lot of you are familiar with this. Am I wrong? User story mapping? Jeff Patton is a great writer. It's a really, really good book, user story mapping. But on this user story mapping, you define who your users are, and you define what they could be doing with your solution. So these are, this is meant to make me run between the two screens. So these are the options. You may not want to implement all of them. What options are you going to provide for your customers? And then this is your output. This is all the things that you could do. Maybe that's your experiments. We're going to do the first slice. But how the user story map works is that the slices through the map lead to a goal. So the outcomes are really what you achieve. If you deliver that slice, what have you achieved? What is the result? It's a beautiful technique. It's really good for creating shared understanding within the teams. Okay, next one is the goal-oriented product roadmap. It's by the German guy who lives in London called Roman Pichler. And it's really simple. So it says, this is how we are going to deliver to the customer. Each vertical is a release, if you will. Each release has a date and a name, and then it has a goal. So why are we doing this release? How often, as part of a team, you know why this is being done? Because we always focus on, it's going to go now. It's always focused on the features. We're going to do these features. It's not about features. It's about what goal we want to achieve. And if anything, the last row, metrics, how will we know that we have satisfied the goal? So that's the outcomes. Metrics are measuring your outcomes. And if anything, I would move the metrics up one row. I would like to have goals. What do we want? How will we know we have got it? And then what are we going to produce in order to get it? And that takes me to the next thing, maybe, or no, before this. I said one of the signs of the feature factory is that your roadmap gets fixed too far into the future. So we know what we're going to do up until the end of 2020, because we need certainty, right? In our organizations, leadership wants certainty. So what are you going to deliver to me in Q4 2020? And if you don't know, go and find out, because I'm not giving you any money before you find that out. It's not very helpful. So I find this, again, I found this from another person who maybe is a friend, maybe not. Three friends too many. I always talk about these things as in the next release. We should be committed to the next release. Yes, we will change if we find something really important, but we should be committed. The one after, we plan to do, but if something changes, it changes. And the ones after that are aspirational. Aspirational as in, it will certainly change, but for the purpose of now and the conversation we're having, this is what we are thinking about. And this is analogous to ice, water, and steam. So it's frozen, but if the temperature rises, it can melt. Shit happens, right? This is still fluid, and that's completely up in the air. So it's a nice way to communicate that we know what we want, but we don't know if we're going to deliver it, because if you fix yourself, you're not flexible anymore. You're not agile. You're not adaptive. Okay? Agenda shift is much more than this. It's the whole way of creating conversations to enable the Mike calls it continuous transformation. I love that term, because transformation, we need to get from here to there. And when we got there, we're fine. We just stay there. It never happens that way. We need to keep on transforming, so continuous transformation. And it has the whole, again, I would recommend the book. It even has my name in it somewhere. But what I want to briefly talk about is this, and I find this phenomenally useful. This is so simple and so useful. And I call it change story, like user story, but different. So we believe that moving this wall, folding this wall, will result in creating a larger space. If successful, we might be seeing that larger space, more chairs, more people, I don't know. It's a stupid example, but I'm trying to illustrate it. So you are basically saying, instead of just we're going to do X, you are saying very clearly why you're doing X. And how will you know that doing X led to Y successfully? So that's probably the trickiest thing. How will you know that you are successful? And being brave to define that and see when you are not being successful and change direction and try something else is what one of the big differences between the output thinking and outcome thinking. Does that make any sense? I've used this, I have never yet, I'm sure somebody here will say, yeah, whatever. But I've never come across anybody who I've shared this with that didn't say, ooh, I like that. Because it's simple, simple is crucial. It's simple and it's helpful, useful. Okay? So are we done yet? Time box is everything, says Leo. Here's a tongue-in-cheek. I don't know if you know the phrase tongue-in-cheek, with a bit of humor. Definition of done, again from Mike Burrows. He says, done, somebody's need was met. You're not done when you finished coding or testing or releasing or any of that. You're only done when what you have produced has changed somebody's behavior for the better. And ideally by their definition, not by your definition. Okay? So here's my takeaways. You are very welcome to drop some of them and introduce yours if you got anything out of the session. So the first thing is, I strongly believe that the language is holding us back. We're still inventing the language for what we're doing. What, we're only, 15 years, 20 years into this agile thing? We change very slowly our perceptions and our behaviors. So language is holding us back. We need to create new language and learn it. Secondly, I really like, whatever you are doing, make sure you know who you're doing it for and why. It's really simple. Keep yourself in check. Why am I doing this? Who am I doing it for? And if you can't answer the question, maybe you should stop doing it. It's really important to clearly define what it is that you want to achieve and make sure everybody involved in creating it and everybody affected understands it. So I love the term shared understanding. Create a shared understanding of what you are trying to achieve and shared understanding of how you will know if you are successful or not so that you can adjust. And finally, you're not done until your customer's need has been met. So here's a bunch of resources that I pulled some of these things from. And we have a few minutes for questions. Will the slides be distributed?
We need to distribute the slides.
Yes.
Good, then yes. It's a very simple question to answer, right? Should we do what we did in the morning?
Yeah,
two, four, and the takeaways, so then you can read them. For you, it's going to be expiring as well.
1, 2, 4, all liberating structure.
More or less. It's like 2, 4 takeaways. That's
okay.
That's a new structure.
Okay, I'm here all day today. I'm here this evening. I'm here tomorrow all morning. So,
will you be part of
it? If you want to talk,
coaching clinic.
Yeah.
All right. So if you want to talk, just go to the coaching clinic.
I'm there 11 till 12 tomorrow.
Put your name, pick a time slot, and then he'll be there for you.
Can I just say one thing? Thank you, Paldies.